Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and we are going to start this session with a review. We covered these exact same topics in session 2 way back at the beginning of the year, but obviously we need to review and refresh here as these concepts are very important for musculoskeletal anatomy, and that coverage was quite a while ago. So as mentioned, we will review the vertebral column as well as the spinal nerves, and we will spend the majority of our time reviewing how those spinal nerves will exit the vertebral column through those intervertebral foramina. Now, the vertebral column goes by many different names, the spine, the spinal column, etc. And as we know, it is more than just bone. So we have those joints, which of greatest importance are the intervertebral discs, which are going to be located between the bodies of neighboring vertebrae. There are 5 types of vertebrae. There are these 3 are going to be the movable, and these 2 are going to be immovable, forming bones, or named bones. And there are going to be 7 cervical vertebrae, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar. Again, these are movable, with the immovable sacrum, which is 5 fused sacral vertebrae, and the coccyx being about 4. There can be variation there, but 4 fused coccygeal bones. Now let's review the spinal nerves. There are 31 pairs of spinal nerves, and they are named based on the spinal cord segment from which they originate, as well as the vertebral level it exits. There are going to be 8 cervical spinal nerves. So this is kind of our big difference here comparatively. That's different from how many cervical vertebrae they are. Recall that there are 7 cervical vertebrae and 8 cervical spinal nerve pairs. And that first cervical spinal nerve, or C1, will exit above the first cervical vertebrae. So that's how we can have that extra nerve. So a bit more about that exiting in a moment. The other spinal nerves will match up with the number of vertebrae at each level, except when you get to the coccygeal level, where we only have 1 coccygeal nerve pair, and that's most typically referred to as the coccygeal nerve. Don't forget that most of these spinal nerves will eventually send fibers to form plexuses that are going to innervate both the upper and lower limbs. So just because we're focusing on the more proximal parts right now in this learning objective, don't forget those plexuses. They're huge, and we'll obviously talk about those in more detail as we get to them. One other thing I want to touch on is that, recall that spinal cord ends at about L2, and so that means that all those more distal spinal nerves have to travel a comparatively longer way to reach their intervertebral foramina. So, how do those spinal nerves get out of the vertebral column? Well, remember those intervertebral foramina. So you put 2 vertebrae kind of together, and they will form a intervertebral foramina on both sides. Of note, in the lower vertebral level, so where we have those bigger vertebrae, like the lumbar vertebrae, the spinal nerves will exit in the superior portions of the intervertebral foramen, as you can see here, say with this L3 spinal nerve. The spinal nerves will most typically exit the intervertebral foramen inferior to the same named vertebra. So looking at this image, the L3 spinal nerve is exiting between L3 and L4. All right, so L3 spinal nerve exits between L3 and L4. The L4 spinal nerve will exit between the L4 vertebrae, and here would be the L5 vertebrae. So that's the most typical pattern throughout the vertebral column. The major exception is the cervical region, due to the fact that there are 8 cervical spinal nerves and only 7 cervical vertebrae. The cervical spinal nerves will exit the intervertebral foramen superior to the same named vertebra. So C1 will exit the vertebral column between the skull and C1. So you can see C1 spinal nerve is exiting between the skull and the C1 vertebra. The C2 spinal nerve exits between C1 and C2. So this is C2, between C1 and C2, and then kind of so on. And with C8, so that extra cervical spinal nerve exiting between the C7 and T1 vertebra. So exiting below that vertebra. And then we pick up from there, so you have the T1 spinal nerve exiting inferior to the T1 vertebrae between T1 and T2. So we're getting back to that typical pattern that we'll have throughout the rest of the spinal column. Okay, so why do we care which spinal nerve exits at which level? Other than the fact that it's super cool anatomy, we do want to have a focus on this because intervertebral disc herniation can help you understand which nerves can be impinged. So understanding which nerves are exiting each intervertebral level will give you an idea of which nerve could be affected with an intervertebral disc herniation, which isn't too terribly uncommon. Intervertebral discs tend to herniate posterolaterally. So you have that nucleus pulposus that is going to herniate through the outer annulus fibrosis, and it's going to exit kind of posteriorly, and then it will extend laterally. So say you have a herniation of the intervertebral disc between L3 vertebra and L4 vertebra. And remember, this typically will herniate posterior and then laterally. And now recall that that L3 spinal nerve is going to exit in this intervertebral foramen between L3 and L4, but recall that it exits superior within that intervertebral foramen. So typically, it's going to be protected from that herniation because of how it exits superiorly. So usually not affected by a herniation of that intervertebral disc, but it may affect the spinal nerve in the next intervertebral foramen. So L4 could be affected by that herniation of the intervertebral disc between L3 and L4. Important to note, there is much less space in the intervertebral foramen of the cervical region, which makes sense if you think of the relatively smaller size of the cervical vertebrae. So a herniation that makes its way to the intervertebral foramen in the cervical region won't have room to miss an exiting cervical spinal nerve, as that spinal nerve takes up the majority of the intervertebral foramen. So typically, if it makes it to that intervertebral foramen, it will affect the spinal nerve going through that intervertebral foramen. Excellent, we have made it to the summary slide. Take time to review and practice thinking through a few vertebral levels and what a herniation might affect, and we'll have some practice questions for that. Always feel free to reach out with any questions you may have to me or any of my anatomy colleagues. I thank you for your time and attention, and have a great rest of your day.